Great morning, great morning, great morning. Welcome to Faith Focus Blog Talk Radio Show. I want to mention, I see we have some callers on the line. If you could keep your phone on mute until I open up the line for questions. I appreciate it. That'll kind of help down with the noise in the background. I'm going to start off with some announcements. I'm looking to advertise and promote and help some people with some radio interviews or maybe some radio spins. So if you're a singer, songwriter, or author, a life coach, and you know you want to promote some of your business or advertise, you can reach me at 240-640-5492, or you can email me at faithfocusfinish@gmail.com. That's faithfocusfinish@gmail.com. Guys, I'm telling you, you missed some great shows this week. What I love about my radio show is that it's not like a local station where you only hear it one time. You can actually go back on my actual radio station on Blog Talk and type in Faith Focus Finish, and that's going to come up my actual website. And once you go on that website, just click on follow, and it'll give you all the episodes. But, oh, my God, you could go back and listen to the episodes. I had some great guests this week. I had Dr. Chantrice Holloman. She got on and told her story about, first of all, her book is called Shoes Without Feet. Shoes Without Feet. You got to, guys, I'm telling you, she got a crazy, amazing story. She woke up one day, was having chest pains, kind of find out she was having a heart attack. Ended up in a hospital, but when she woke up, they told her that basically she had to get one leg first they said the toes, and then it went to the leg being amputated, and then next thing you know, she had to get both legs amputated. And that all came from a heart attack, guys. But what I loved about it, her amazing, she kept focused, she stayed positive, she had her family supporting her, praying over her. And so, guys, you got to go and back and listen to that episode. Also, gear her book on Amazon. Amazing story, amazing. And then I also had Yolanda Compass. Her book is called Breaking Free of the Cycle of Destructive Relationships. And she talked about abusive relationships that she's been in from maybe from childhood all the way to adult, abuse through her marriage, and how she broke free from that destructive relationship. And oh my God, she has an amazing story too. I actually met her in person a couple of weeks ago, and a very nice lady, had good energy off of her, because I pick up on energy on people. So she had good energy. Guys, you gotta go read her book too. You can find her on Amazon too. Her name is Yolanda Compass, and the name of her book is Breaker Free of Destructive Relationships. Now, to my guest that I have today, Mr. Antonio Brooks. Now, I had Mr. Antonio on the show last week. We did a part one. And after we got off the show, we was like, we didn't even get to all the meat of the book. So I decided to ask him to come back, because I know this is an important topic to talk about on the men and the women's side about child support. So the name of his book is Child Support, How I Paid It and Still Made It. And this is episode number two. So I just want to welcome Mr. Antonio. Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Antonio. I meant to unmute you. I just want to welcome Mr. Antonio. Good morning. Welcome him to the Faith Focus Blog Talk Radio Show. Great morning, Mr. Antonio. How are you?
Pleasure. Glad to be back. We had a wonderful conversation last Saturday, and I anticipate having another one today.
Yes, sir. And just a little bit about, because I know I'm going to probably forget some parts of it, but I'm just going to briefly give you a little bit about what happened last week, but not give you too much, because I want you guys to go back and listen to episode one so you can understand how we got to where we are on part two. But briefly, he was paying his child's mother. I think it was your daughter, Mr. Antonio?
Yeah.
Okay, he was paying his daughter's mother through his job, where they actually wrote her a check out. And one day she just decided to take him to court. And when he went to court, they told him that he still had to pay $25,000 in back child support and said it was a gift. So if you want to hear about the beginning of that journey, you have to go back to episode one and listen to that. But we did make it up to a part where you had played some numbers and hit on some numbers. So let's start from here, because I want them to go back and listen to that other episode. So let's I want to start right where I'm sorry. I want to start when you hit the number. And, you know, we could tell a little bit back about what happened with that, and then we can go forward with the rest of the show. Okay.
Yeah. Well, basically, I played for a number, and come to find out, the number came out. I went to collect the money, and when I got there, they gave me paperwork to fill out. But unbeknownst to me, if you owe back child support, student loans, or unemployment, and you catch the lotto or whatever the case may be, they won't pay you because you have to pay that money back. Well, in my case, I didn't have student loans, and I've never been unemployed, and it was child support. And when I got there, the lady told me, I can't give you the money because you owe child support and that. And I went berserk because I knew at that time my child support was completely paid off. But what happened was the child support system and the Florida, state of Florida system wasn't linked together at that time. So the state of Florida system only showed that child support was owed, and it puts a block on paying me the money that was due to me. And we went back and forth, the police was called, and things totally got out of hand. And then later they found out that I was telling the truth, and they had to give me the money.
Okay. So the crazy exciting part, because the part that you missed out on was when the police was following you down the street after you left there.
They, you know, as I was there, a black police officer showed up, and he said, listen, man, I'm on child support. I understand where you're coming from, but I need you to calcm down because you're in the middle of Doral. And anybody that knows Doral, Florida, is predominantly all white, all Republican area. And he said, man, I need you to calm down. When these other officers come, their aggression is going to be high. So they came, they called to me, and the supervisor from the lotto office came out. She said, well, give me your name and information and come back tomorrow morning. Call me when you're on your way here. I help you deal with this. And, you know, but we're about to close. I need you to leave. I get in my car, and I start driving, and I'm pissed, and I'm pulling off. And, like, 2 seconds later, I see about 30 police cars following me. So I'm looking, and as I'm driving, I slowed down and just jumped out of my car, and I'm pissed, and I'm yelling at me, like, wait a minute, calm down. I said, what? You know, I'm not giving you money. I'm already pissed off. Why are you bother me now? He said, first of all, you didn't put your car in park, and your car's rolling down the street. The lady, the state of Florida, just called back and said, you were telling the truth. You can go back and get your money. I turn around, I look at my car, and I look at the lotto office, and I just started running down the street. Man, I'll get that car later. So by the time I got back, everybody in the lotto, I snatched the door open, everybody in the lotto office jumped up and started clapping. Because I had caused a big ruckus in there. And people didn't understand why I was causing a ruckus, but she's standing there with the check plastered to the bulletproof glass, and she's like, Mr. Brooks, please come get some money. Just get some money. And it turned out pretty good, but the police had to send another police car to ease my car on the side of the road because I never put it in the park.
Wow. Shoot, I would have been running down that street too. Wow. Wow. That's crazy. Well, yeah, I mean, a lot of people don't know that when you hit the lottery or you hit a number and things like that, they take that too. I mean, they try to take as much as they can from a person. And I don't even have kids, and I know a little bit about that. That they try to take as much as they can to keep you just as low as possible. But at the same time, I understand, you know, some of the system, because there are people out here that's literally not taking care of their kids, and they purposely are not working because of that reason. And I know quite a few people that do that. And I think it's pretty sick and sad anyway that somebody would do that and not want to take care of their responsibilities. But, I mean, that's, you know, I really commend you from doing, stepping up and taking care of your responsibilities And I forgot, I don't remember, did you mention that you guys were in a relationship, or you and the child's mother?
Yeah, me and my daughter's mother, we was in a relationship roughly 2 years, and we never lived together, but we were in a relationship, then my daughter was conceived. So, things transpired in the way that they did. I've always had a job, so it was more of the money that she's receiving from me that I set up. Other outside influences and family members were like, well, you know, he's a county employee. You can get more, you can get more, you can get more. So I think that's how that transpired. You know, after talking to my mother, she said, as a woman's going to do whatever she says she needs to do to take care of her kids and provide for her kids. But in your case, you're taking care of your daughter. My daughter was the only grandchild in my family. And you can imagine. Mm-hmm.
I don't know, she's probably getting spoiled rotten then.
Exactly. So, you know, I feel that it was a need for that because my daughter got anything she needed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you felt that my daughter was getting older. It was just basically a conversation. I went and set the child support up through my job, thinking I was doing the right thing as a father. But kind of find out, giving money or providing finance to a woman when it comes to her child and it doesn't go through the court system, it's considered as a gift. But I didn't know that at the time. I thought I was just doing what I was supposed to do as a father.
Now, when you first told me that, that was new to me. That definitely was new to me. And I think it's pretty sad that they won't allow people to work things out between each other. Now, I can understand if the guy only giving her $20 or $30, that's something different. But if you actually receive, if she's receiving an actual check, and that you're actually doing something, then to me, me personally, I have a problem with that. But that's just my own personal opinion.
You know, most people would say, you know, you should have went to court with an attorney. I mean, the thing, my theory of thinking was, I went to the payroll department on my job. I set this up. It's not like I'm going to court and saying, Your Honor, I did this, I did that. It was in black and white on my job's letterhead. And it proved the amount of money on a consecutive basis that she was receiving from me. So I would get paid on a Thursday. She would get the check on a Wednesday, and it would have her name in care of my daughter from me, Dade County Public Schools. So it wasn't like it was questionable. You know, I had a track record of it. So I said, there's no need for me to go to court with an attorney. I got the proof right here in black and white. It didn't work out that way.
Wow.
So, you know, when I gave the paperwork to the judge, he said, you gave her this money? I said, yeah, it's right there in black and white. On a consecutive basis, every 2 weeks, it went to her with no headache, no argument, no nothing. So he said, well, I'm sorry to tell you, the money you gave her was a gift. You owe the state of Florida $25,000. And I was just informed that you own a passport. You got 24 hours to put your passport on my desk, your flight list.
Wow. Well, you know, sometimes we got to listen to key words, too, because I just heard a key word today that I know you said to me last week, and it just woke me up today, where he asked you, did you give her this money? The word was give. And that's why he took it as a gift. Yeah, that's sad. Because, there's some people out here that's not even trying to do that at all. And I'm sorry?
Yeah, the way the state of Florida does it, or any other state, I ended up in debt with the state of Florida for $25,000 based on the fact that she went and got food stamps and Medicaid, which is considered as AFDC, a government assistance. So the way the state looks at it as if we provided this for your child. You were the absentee parent or father. And that created a bill over 5 years, 10 years, or whatever it may be. So when they do finally contact the absentee parent, and we also keep saying absentee parent, because women pay child support now too. But in my case, I was an absentee parent in their eyes. So by the time I went to court, the food stamps and the Medicaid that she received filled up to $25,000. The money that I was giving her, instead of it going through the court system, and then the court system gives to her. And the reason why the court system wants to get involved, they want to make sure that the bill that was created, some of the money that I'm paying is going to be deducted to go back towards that bill. So that's why I was told that the money that I gave her was a gift, because the court system didn't get their portion. And now I'm in the rear of $25,000. And what a lot of people don't understand is child support is a form of bad debt. It's on your credit report. A lot of people don't know that.
So then one of the other things is, too, now I understand, because she probably didn't report it either to food stamps and social services was one of the other reasons, too. She should have been reporting that, which I'm surprised they didn't catch that or mention anything about that in court. Because actually, to be honest with you, that's actually a fraud that she didn't report it to them that you were actually paying. Because I know that's the first thing. Yeah. I'm sorry.
Now, the day that I went to court, had she stepped up and said, "Well, Your Honor, he did give me this money." Not that she had to, because I already had it in black and white. She could have requested that the court system, the state of Florida, give me credit for the $15,000 that I've already given her. Had she requested that, I wouldn't be in debt in the state of Florida for $25,000, which is crazy, because you have it in black and white from my job saying that I did do this. But if she would have stepped up and just said, "Your Honor, he deserves to have credit because he did do this." Right. I'm going to say if I was stuck with the $25,000.
I don't understand why people do that. Because I know someone that's paying child support, and the father know that the mother is doing what she, you know, taking care of the kid. Plus, she's disabled. But he's that type of person that he would not step up, that he would actually do that. And so I don't know why people do that, but if the shoes was on the other foot, then how would they feel about that situation?
Exactly.
I know you had mentioned before that you said that they that you ended up getting arrested behind that, about the child support.
Yes. No one can really imagine, once child support is set up and it does hit the gavel, whatever you're required to pay, that's your payment until that child either A, turns 18, or B, graduates from high school. C, if the child decides to go to college, you have to pay child support until they're 23, but they must maintain a B average in all of their classes.
Mm-hmm.
Now, back to your question. My child support is payroll deducted, meaning I never miss a payment. If I get paid three times in 1 month, they're going to continue to take the payment out. If my child support is payroll deducted, and I never miss a payment, I get pulled over in my car going to work, and the police come back and say, "There's a warrant for your arrest." I said, "Excuse me?" He said, "Because of child support." I said, "It can't be possible, because it's payroll deducted." Between the court system and the payroll department on my job, they never miss a payment. It comes out of what happens is people don't update their systems. Child support, payroll department on my job, somewhere there's a missing link somewhere, and it doesn't show that it's payroll deducted with the state of Florida. So the state of Florida automatically sends out an arrest warrant for me, or, you know, that particular father or person who's paying the child support. So now you can imagine, at 5:45 in the morning, I'm on my way to work and get pulled over, and he tells me I have to take you to jail because there's a warrant for your arrest of child support.
Wow.
Now, I go to jail. My car is told, get to jail. When I get there, I get booked in. I'm highly pissed off. Not even there a good hour. Get into a fight with somebody there. Now I got another charge.
Oh,
plus
my
the
God.
That I got, which I shouldn't even be here to get this charge, because it's payroll deducted. And after being there 12 hours, they realize, "Mr. Brooks shouldn't even be here, because, yes, he was telling the truth. It's payroll deducted. They didn't update their system." But now I got to get out, bond out, get my car out of the pound, take this paperwork to my job, explain why I got arrested. Because, you know, I work for the school system. I'm around children. I can't have a record. So it's a headache. It's just total chaos. More money coming out of my pocket, plus the child support. So I'm just throwing away money now.
So wait a minute, you had to bond out. You had to bond out because of the fight and not because of child support.
No, I had to bond out. In certain cases, they won't give you a bond when it's dealing with child support at all. Depending on the amount of money that you owe. But when they realized that it wasn't my fault that I was there, they ended up letting me out on that particular situation. But then I got into the fight that was in there. I had to pay for the bond, but I'm telling the judge, I would have never gotten into a fight if I wasn't here. It was your fault that I'm here.
Exactly. Wow. Yeah. Well, we have a bunch of callers on the call, and it seems like someone wants to ask a question. I'm going to open up the lines to anyone if they have any questions. They want to ask Antonio. I just opened up the line. Do anybody have any questions you want to ask Mr. Antonio?
I'm like, would you do enough?
All right. No one has any questions. I'm going to put everybody back on mute again. Did anybody have any questions? We definitely got a lot of callers on the line. Well, I'm going to take a quick break right quick, and then we're going to come back and finish on a little bit on your book. I'll be right back, guys. Welcome back. the Faith Focus Fitness Blog Talk Radio Show, and I'm on the line with Mr. Antonio Brooks. We were talking about
called
child support, how I paid it and made it. So we were just talking about you just bonded out of jail, and you had to report to your job the reason why you were in jail. Now, what happened with that?
Yeah.
Because I can't imagine you had to go to court, go to work and explain to them that you got arrested and why you got arrested. So what happened with that with your job?
Yeah, well, when you work for Dade County Public Schools, you have to report any arrest within 24 hours. So I had to get all the paperwork from the court system, take it to my job, present it to HR, explaining them what happened. And I was facing either suspension or termination, because when you work around children, you can't have a felony and things of that nature. When they realized that it was child support, and it was, you know, we have thousands of employees that are on child support, I had to actually prove to them that, you know, I got mistakenly arrested. They gave me everything in black and white, so that the system didn't coincide that I was actually paying. They called over to the payroll department to see if the money was coming out of my check like it was supposed to. They, you know, concurred that. And then they realized that, you know, there was an honest mistake and I wasn't in jeopardy of being suspended or losing my job.
Wow. And it's crazy because I get it on both ends. I do. I definitely get it. But you definitely got to, you know, make sure you take care of responsibility. But at the same time, how can you pay anything if you went to jail? If they taking your license from you, can't get to work, you know, you got to catch the bus to work. I mean, that's crazy right there, or walk to work. I mean, you need your license to drive to work. Then they take your passport, which I understand people leaving the country on that part. I definitely do, because, I mean, people murdering people and they leaving the country. So I do understand that part. But they're putting people in jail constantly and building up a record where they can't get a job because they have a record now. I mean, some of the stuff is not, I mean, they need to really redo that law, because I think it's pretty ridiculous the way they do some of it. I mean, I can understand people, like I said, that's definitely not trying to take care of their kids. So.
Yeah, the sad part about that situation is if you go to jail, like you said, you can't pay the child support. The kid is not taken care of. The mother doesn't receive anything. The court system don't get their money back that they gave her for food stamps and Medicaid. So it's catch-22. I've been sitting in the courtroom, and the judge say, you know, you don't have any money. You owe this money. Do you have any money today to put on this bill so you don't get arrested? And it's like, well, you gotta watch it on. Take your watch off. You got earrings on. Take your earrings off, you know. And then they have someone put it in a bag, and they take it around the corner, and they see what your personal belongings weigh, and they come back and say, well, between your watch, your earrings, and your bracelet, you know, the chain, it's worth $300. So we're going to confiscate this and put that $300 towards the bill that you owe the state of Florida. So you don't go to jail.
Wait a minute. You just got me messed up in the head right now. They got you in court. They win your jury. So basically, they jacked you in court. Wow.
I've seen it with my own two eyes. I was like, are you serious?
Wow.
And, you know, the sad part about this whole thing is, like I said, child support is a form of bad debt. In today's society, when you go to apply for a job, most jobs check your credit report.
Right.
When they take your credit report to see that you owe $50,000, $60,000, $90,000 in child support, that could be the deciding factor based on them hiring you or not.
Right.
So now, you stick this on my credit report, but then tell me to go get a job. How? It's a catch-22.
Right.
I can understand if I owe this money, but keep it off my credit report, maybe I can get this job and then be able to pay you, take care of the kid, and the whole nine. But it's crazy. And especially, I know some guys that work on the oil rig in different places. They need a passport to be able to leave the country to go work on an oil rig or out of town or abroad or whatever the case may be. In certain circumstances, depending on the amount of money that you owe, a judge can say, I'll give you a temporary passport to be able to travel for work-related issues only. No legal, right. Order, no going and hanging out. It has to be work-related for you to go. But other than that, if you owe $2,501, you cannot possess a passport. But if you owe $2,499, $1 under $25,000, you can get a passport.
Wow. And a lot of people don't know that. I mean, right. I didn't know it. I don't learn the laws anyway because I don't have any kids, but a lot of people don't know that. I want to open up the lines one more time. Did you want to talk about anything else about your book? Because I know I want to talk to you about your nonprofit organization, too, for a couple minutes before we end the show. Was there anything yes. else that you want to talk about that's in your book before I open up the lines for questions?
Well, you know, I don't want to give them too much because, you know, I want people to go out there and purchase the book. The book will be set up on Amazon within the next 7 days. We had a little issue, but we are technically trying to get that all resolved. But as of right now, if you want an autographed copy of my book, you can send a money order to P.O. Box 700662, Miami, Florida, 33170. Or you can inbox me on Facebook at Antonio H.P. Brooks to get other information. You can cash at me also, and the cost will be $24. I'll autograph the book, and I'll mail it direct to you. Just inbox me your address, and I ship out books every week, Wednesday.
All right, there it is, guys. This sounds like a very interesting book. Again, you got to listen to episode one and hear how he started his journey on this, with the child support. It's a lot of information I didn't know. Also on the back of Antonio's book, if you want to explain that right quick to Antonio, the back of the book.
Yes, in the back of the book, I took the liberty of putting down frequently asked questions about child support. Most of the time when a man just puts on child support, before he gets the right answer, he'll ask one of his friends or family members. But they're going to tell them what happened to them in their situation, which may not be his situation. Child support is so crazy. Everybody's situation is totally different. So when you're in the courtroom and you hear legal terms and certain words being said, you're standing there and you don't even understand what these words mean. So you're agreeing to the words and you're just, you know, shaking your head because you just want to get out of there. It's total chaos. But I got frequently asked questions in the back of the book. I got words with the definitions in the back of the book. And I also have any child support office on this planet with their email, address, phone number for every state all the way to Hawaii and Guam. So if you're on child support and you want to try to get it remodified and you don't know where to go, pick up my book, find out what state the child support order was conducted in, and you can contact it. It also has a phone number for every child support office in the back of the book.
All right, I like it, man, and did his research. I'm going to open up the lines right quick for any questions. So if anybody have any questions, I see we have a couple of 305 area codes, 678, 786 numbers. So I'm just going to open up the lines. If anyone have any questions that you want to ask Mr. Antonio.
Hello.
Yes. Yes, caller, come in.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Hi, this isn't actually a question. This is actually Antonio's daughter.
Oh, God, my daughter's on the line. How you doing, baby?
Hi. I'm just calling to support the call. That's all.
Oh, that was sweet. Thank you.
You're welcome. Love you too, Danny. 23 years old now. We did the whole child support thing. She realized a lot of things that were said about her father wasn't true. I've always been there for her no matter what. I paid the child support, and when she called and, Daddy, I need, I still did. So I love you, baby.
I love you too. Can I get $50?
Get off the phone.
Thank you, though. I want to get the information to listen to the first call because he just informed me about this one, maybe like 10 minutes before the call. So I'm going to get the information from him so I can listen to the first one.
Excellent.
All right, I love you.
One of the things I want to say that once you go on the website, it's called Blog Talk Radio. Make sure you follow it because in that way it'll send you emails to up and coming guests, and that way you can listen to us all the time. How about that?
Okay, that's fine. I would love that.
Thank you.
All right.
Any other callers?
Bye, Daddy. Love you.
Bye bye.
Bye.
Hello.
Any other callers on the line that had any question? I think I heard a male's voice.
Hello.
Yes. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. This is Mike Gaynor. Just calling in to Tony. I appreciate all the information that you have given. I have lived what you have gone through with the arrest, with the money being paid, even telling. Been in a situation where there was not a blood test given, and I still had to pay the support, and the judge told me to feed the baby until it looked like me, and hit the gallon call for the baby. There are so many things that transpire within the system that we are not aware of, and it is a blessing for you to educate people and tell them and give them resources and use your story as an example. I appreciate the information. And also, anyone that's connect, that credit thing is serious. You can have paid that money and be paying it in its own time. It's payroll deducted. And if you owe a dollar, it is on your credit report as an unpaid debt, which impacts it negatively, I mean harshly. And now I'm on the other end of receiving support. So I get it from both ends, but if you are taking care of your child, if you are taking care of your child, that system, that child support system, is set up for you to lose. It is set up for you to lose. And I'll give you a quick example. I'm paying the support. The support is killing me. Dade County employee coming out my check, hit half the check, gone. So I get a second job, a full-time job, an eight-hour job. I'm on this job. I'm rolling. Everything is working out. I'm bouncing my life. Mind you, it's 80 hours a week that I'm working now. But then they hit that check. For half.
Exactly.
I can't do it. I can't do 80 hours for half of everything. I cannot. So it puts you in a situation where, man, I'm taking care of my kids. And mind you, if they need anything, daddy going to get it. Daddy going to get it. But I have to pay the money to the state. It creates bitterness. It creates harsh feelings when the other party could ease it, but they choose not to. And that's where that resentment comes in. And I'm not talking about for the deadbeat mom, deadbeat dad. This is not a conversation for them. It's for the ones that are providing, are taking care of those kids. I feel you, Tony, in your book, the emotion in it, the expression in it, the facts that are in it. It is a blessing to anyone that wants information about the child support system, how to navigate that system. I've read the book. It's not a part in it that I don't love, that I don't appreciate, that I wish I would have had it 30 years ago.
Child support turned me into a straight hustler. And for the rest of the call and faith, the gentleman that you're talking to right now, his name is Michael Gaynor. He's the person that sowed the seed in me to inspire me to write this book. He's the author himself. His first book is called Dumbass Me. And I was on the circuit with him, you know, traveling around the country, helping him sell his books. And I was talking to him while we'd be driving in the car, going to certain book signings in and out of town. He told him what I was dealing with. He said, man, you need to write this. And I was like, yeah, whatever. He said, no, I'm serious. You need to write this because you have a story to tell. You know what I'm saying? So the seed that, you know, you dropped in me, Mike, I really appreciate it. And that's the reason why this book is born today. He's been a big brother. He's been a mentor to, you know, deal with this. And a lot of stuff that I went through, he didn't even know that I dealt with child support in depth in the way that I did. But I think what he was saying And I just broke down one day and just started writing. He said, just write it. Don't worry about how it sounds, how it come out. That's what an editor's for. You know, and he's the person that, you know, I got to proofread my book. What would be a better person than somebody who's already walked that road and laid the pavements for me to walk over? So I think I've thanked him 1,000 times since I started, you know, writing this book and got it done. So, big bro, I take my hat off to you, man. Anybody that hasn't picked up his book, Dumbass Me, you've got to read that book. It's hot.
Well, I was going to say, I would love to have you on my show. I want to get the book myself and read it, and love to have you on my show. Because everybody's story is a custom, you know, made for them. So I definitely want to hear about your story. And then also, yes, sir. And at the end of the show, you can get my information from Antonio. One of the things is too, Antonio talked about how he was able to catch himself up, you know, through building businesses and working his job at the same time. Because, of course, if you go out and get more jobs, they're going to think that you got more money. That way.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm sorry.
I could tell you, you know, when my situation, you know, reading my book, if you know me, you knew that I got out and, you know what I'm saying, I did catering and I notarized papers, you know, when the housing market was good, if a person had a closing on their house and the closing was $8,000, it was nothing for me to go notarize those papers, sign here, make $800 cash, you know, you know, cooking for a wedding, for a party, even repads. People would call me to cook for a repast. So, you know, I did a lot of things. I even got a property and repossession license. I talked to my boss and said, look, man, I'm paying a healthy child support payment. And he was like, you know, you're good at what you do. You got your license in the state of Florida. I'll pay you under the table just to keep you here because I was going to quit because they started attacking that particular paycheck. So, you know, a lot. It really turned me into a hustler. You know, whether I wanted to be one or not, but I knew I had to live. I knew it was a particular lifestyle that I wanted to live. You know what I'm saying? And I'm real particular about my clothes. I buy clothes. None of my clothes go into a washing machine. I send them to the cleaners. So I had to learn how to adjust and navigate around all of that. Being able to pay it and still make it and you know, try to survive.
Wow. Yeah. I mean, I'm just at a loss of words. I'm sorry?
It's certainly an adjustment to adjust to paying child support, and you have this child that you're looking at that's looking up to you and to be an example to them. And none of what you're going through is their business. And on either end, if the business of your mother is not this or your daddy is not doing this, I wish that could just be avoided. It would save so much heartbreak and so much damage to the child, because at the end of the day, the relationship should be between the two adults. The relationship between the children should be the parents. There is nothing that I wouldn't do to make sure that my children had. And oftentimes, I drove off with just enough money to make it home. You know, just to make sure that they had. And I have paid the child support. But I want to hang out with my kids. They want to go and do things. You know, we can only go to the beach, the free thing, so much. We can only go to the park so much. I want to do things with them. I want to create memories. I want to create footprints where they can look back and say, hey, I enjoyed this with my father. I want to have first with them. And it's very difficult to do it when you don't have any money. So I said that because that hustling part of it, you have to. You have to hustle. You have to find things that you can do. And I didn't know that when I called Tony and said, hey, man, bro, I need you to come with me and you need to move these books. You know, he's like, let's go. Or I would give him a case of books, 52 books. And 2 days later, he'll call me and say, bro, I need another case. You know, that is the spirit of how he got out and made money. And he was my go-to man for everything that I needed, not knowing that he was under all this pressure. So it breaks a weak person. It breaks them. It keeps them running. It keeps them working at a job for 2 or 3 weeks till the people get onto them, and then they quit, and then they go to another job. If you got a child, you're going to do what you got to do to take care of them. And you cannot run from the state. You can run to another state. But if you plan on staying, you got to pay that money. Or you got to keep looking over your shoulder. They suspend your license. They take everything that they can get from you. And you just create more of a hole for yourself. And like you said earlier, you know, when they arrest you, if you stand there for 30 days, 60 days, 90 days, that child support doesn't stop. You're even more in the hole. Anyone that is listening to this that is currently paying child support, go hard, grind. It is not forever. The 18 years seem like a long time. But your relationship with your child is what's important. Your relationship with your child should drive you a little more, a little harder, and know that those days are going to pass. You don't want to sacrifice the relationship with your child because of the system or because of the absent parent. And that's in this book as well. Make sure that you read it, make sure that you grab a copy of it. It is a great book. It is a great tool, and it's a forever tool.
Wow. I really appreciate that. You know, and to piggyback off what he was saying, the relationship with the child is the most important thing. You know, it hurts me as a man to be able to tell my daughter that I couldn't do certain things because they don't understand that at a small age. But now, as my daughter's 23, believe it or not, on Sunday we have what's called Daddy Daughter Day. She's 23 years old, and she got her own life. She got a boyfriend. She got things going on. But that was the time that we chose, now that she's older, on Sundays, I block off time and we go to dinner. We might go to a movie, we might go and hang out, get ice cream or whatever. Y'all just ride around the car and talk. You know, and a lot of people are like, you're 23 and y'all hanging out. I'm like, yeah, this is my time to spend with my child. Because I feel like I lost a lot of her younger, you know, years dealing with child support, financially wasn't able to do certain things. My son lives in Georgia. Certain parts of my son feel that I do more for my daughter than I do for him. And I told him it's not like that because his sister sees me more because we live in the same state. He's 20 now. You know what I'm saying? So now I have a better relationship with him, being able to talk to him direct and let him know this is what took place. But I really got to take my hat off to the real MVP dealing with any child support situation. And that's the woman that's dealing with this man who's paying that healthy child support payment. She's a real MVP, if you ask me, because it makes the bills in their household lopsided for quite some time.
Right.
And if the person's not us, but like I was, majority of the bills is going to be paid by that woman. And whatever he's left with out of his check, he's trying to pitch in and fill in. Like I said, for roughly 3 years, I was bringing home $225 out of my check, out of a $1,700 check. So, you know, like when I say the woman is the real MVP, that woman that still loves that man, that knows he's trying to take care of those kids, and she's sticking with him and help, you know, dealing with the kids and help buying school clothes and paying for field trips and stuff like that and school pictures, she's the real MVP. That's you know, so any man that has a woman that's sticking by her, take your hat off to her, you know what I'm saying, and do what you can to uplift her spirit because her spirit is going to be down because there's some things that she want to do and financially, you guys are not able to do that.
Right. Wow. That's real deep, especially to hear it on that side, too, and to hear that you're even mentioning women being MVP. So, wow. Well, I mean, we have 7 minutes left of the show. I know I wanted to talk a little bit about your nonprofit organization. I want to spend a couple of minutes talking about that, and then I want to want you to mention the information again about how to get in contact with you so we can do that in 5 minutes. Then the last 2 minutes I'll spend it making my last bit of announcements. So tell me a little bit about your nonprofit organization.
Yes. In 2012, I started a nonprofit organization. It's called Fight for Life. I saw my mom and one of my best friends pass from cancer. And while they was fighting and dealing with their battle, the insurance companies would pay a certain portion for their medicine. Well, if they use more medicine this month and they need more medicine, the insurance company would deny them. So I came up with a concept where, you know, aggravation and stress will kill you quicker than any health element that you're dealing with. So to alleviate that aggravation and that stress, I came up with Fight for Life. I would use boxing gloves, pink for women, red for me. I would get their family members to sign the gloves, family members, friends, co-workers, neighbors, or whatever, they would sign the gloves, and they would give a donation. It could be from a dollar all the way up to, you know, whatever the person decided to give. And we would take that money, and then whatever that person is dealing with, whether they need more medicine, that money would go towards getting them some more medicine, whether it be pain medicine or, you know, if I had a young lady, she, her life was off, her kids didn't have families and milk, and she was worse dealing with cancer. And I told her, I said, if I can alleviate the families and the milk and get your life back on, you focus on getting better. And the her amount of stress went down drastically. So I raised that money, paid the light bill, and paid for the families and milk. And I took a small portion out to go back towards the nonprofit for operational costs. And the gloves that were given to her, I got those gloves out of my own pocket. So that small portion went back to replace those gloves. And you know, the way we do it is, we provide the gloves for this family member, take a little portion out, and then you pay it for another family member. And that's, I've been doing this since 2012 all by myself. And at that time, I was still paying the child support. So I was taking out $20 a year, $30 a year. I have a bank account set up at BGT under Fight for Life. Anybody want to give a donation, you can. But it's harder for me versus someone like Susan G. Coleman in the National Cancer Society. It was a big organization. But if you contact them, hey, I got cancer and no food in my refrigerator, they're going to tell you, we raised money for research. And I got tired in the end. We raised money for research.
Wow. So we want to, you know, if anybody want to donate to his organization, that would be so beautiful to go to the BB&T and ask for the Fight for Life account so you can donate to that. And like I mentioned to you before, Antonio, I do want to do a live Facebook Live with you. And eventually, once we get you on LinkedIn, do a live on that also so that we can help you raise the money for your organization. Because I appreciate what you're doing. Actually, my mom, I had a good friend that died of ovarian cancer. My mom died of breast cancer. So and it was one of the reasons why she just wasn't, you know, they had financial issues. And the things that they died from, they said they shouldn't have died from, but because financial reasons, you know, and that's helping, you know, paying life bill or mortgage and all those things. A lot of people don't look at those factors while you're healthy. And so, you know, with saving money and things like that. So it's very important, but I appreciate what you're doing.
You know what it's like to have cancer? And either A, don't have a way to get your cancer treatment. I have a young lady, I raise money, and I pay Uber to take her to her cancer treatment and pick up and take her back home.
Wow.
It's just as simple as that. That alleviated a whole lot of stress from her, like, you know, knowing that, you know, the state don't help me with this and don't help me with that. I said, don't worry about it. You need to go, I'll pay for Uber or Lyft to take you to your cancer treatment. Don't worry about it.
Wow.
My mom
is
one of my best friends.
Wow. Well, I appreciate you doing that, Antonio. I really do. One of the things that I do for some of the new callers and listeners, I actually work in the insurance industry. And what I do is I help people before they even have heart attacks, strokes, cancers, kidney failures, and things like that. I actually do a life insurance policy that basically says if you have a heart attack, stroke, cancer, lose a limb, go blind from diabetes and things like that, you can actually use a portion of that policy to help you pay your bills off or pay your mortgage. And that money goes directly to the client and not to the lender. And so some of those things will help us, you know, you got to get ahead of it before, because they say it's a 50-50 chance that we'll have any of those illnesses or maybe one or two of those illnesses at one time. And so even though Antonio have that off nonprofit organization, if you can get yourself in position before that, I could actually educate you. I could actually, you know, show you what we do. And then I can actually show you according to your budget. And this is insurance outside of your job, because if you get fired, laid off, or quit, you lose your insurances. So this is something that you have control of. So that'll be some things, too, that can kind of help out on the same spectrum before and after. So we only have 90 seconds left, Mr. Antonio. If you could shout out how they can get in contact with you before the show cut us off.
You can email me at TonioHPBrooks@gmail.com, Facebook, Antonio HP Brooks, Instagram, Antonio9001. Inbox me for information and details on how to purchase the book. Like I said, I autograph it and I mail it back to you. Mike, I want you to take advantage of her show. You guys, I'll get you the information to hook up with her.
I appreciate it.
Fellas, put yourself on child support. Don't let a bill rack up. Go down there, put yourself on child support. It's going to be better for you in the long run.
Yeah, amen. Well, I appreciate you guys getting on. I want you to have a great day because it's getting ready to cut us off. So have a great and blessed day. And thank you so much. Talk to you soon.
I thank you.
Right.